What is wrong with you guys? How could you say this is the best Spider-Man movie of all time? Yo, what's going on, guys? It is the Ultimate Frozen Fan back here doing another rant video. It's been quite a while since I've done one of these. I think the last one I did was the whole thing about why Mario gets so much praise, whereas Sonic gets so much hate. Might remember, I'll have it here in the corner for a refresher, you see. And I'll also leave the link to it in the description below. Wanted to make another one because I had to get something on my chest. So I'm sure you could tell by the title of the video, like what the rant's going to be about and stuff. But So Spider-Man is my favorite superhero of all time. But when I say Spider-Man, I'm more specifically referring to Peter Parker Spider-Man, not Miles Morales or Spider-Gwen or Spider-Noir or 2099, any of those ones. So I was less than excited for Into the Spider-Verse way back in 2018 when that came out. I really had no intention of seeing it. I thought it looked stupid and an insult to Spider-Man. But I was told by, like, my friend and, you know, like, oh, you know, you gotta watch it, it's so good. And, you know, the community was raving, saying that it's the best Spider-Man ever, and everyone, you know, should see it and everything. And critics loved it, and it even managed to take home the Academy Award, beating out the much better Ralph Breaks the Internet of that year. So it was very, very sad about that. One of these days, I was gonna finally get around to watching it, but if I was gonna watch it, I wasn't gonna pay for it. I wasn't gonna buy it. I wasn't gonna rent it. I definitely wasn't gonna pay to see it in theaters. It had to be some kind of free viewing. So luckily, on Xfinity On Demand, it was available through FX On Demand until September 30th. So last Tuesday when I got the chance, when my dad was out of town and the TV was free for a long time that night, I finally sat down and decided to watch it and see, because I'd been, you know, judging it so much, saying, oh, stupid, horrible, and, you know, but it's not really fair to, you know, judge it if I haven't even seen it. So I wanted to finally see it so that I could make the decision for myself of, you know, if it really is, you know, as bad as I think it's going to be and as I'm always saying it is, you know, if I'm going to like. Because, and I wanted to make sure that I watched the entire thing before passing judgment, because if I just watched a few minutes of it or like half of it, then people are like, no, you got to see it to the end, you know, you got to watch the whole thing. The ending's really good, you know, so. As much as it pained me, I watched the entire thing and really regret watching it. Wish I hadn't. That's 2 hours of my life that I will never get back. And for this video, I'm gonna talk about all the reasons why I hated this movie and why I don't think it's the best Spider-Man movie ever made, like so many others think. So, okay. So, first things first. First thing that really sucks about this movie is that Peter Parker Spider-Man is dead. Just like in the comics, just like in these two Ultimate Spider-Man comics right here, the death of Spider-Man and the death of Spider-Man Fallout, Spider-Man is dead. He doesn't die in the same way that he does in those comics, but he still dies. And so then Miles Morales has to kind of step up and become the new Spider-Man who I knew like little to nothing about Miles Morales going in to this. I'd never read any of his comics or anything. So not being familiar with the character is, you know, one thing that's, you know, also kind of a turnoff. It's like, oh, well, you know, if I don't know anything about this character, you know, why am I, you know, gonna, you know, like him and stuff. So, anyways, So Kingpin is the bad guy in this, and his whole thing is that he's making like a machine that can open a portal to other parallel dimensions and stuff. Spider-Man's trying to stop it. But King, oh, the reason Kingpin wants to open the portal to the other universe is because he thinks he can get his family back, because his family in that universe died because they witnessed him, like, he had a guy up against the wall like this, and he was like, punch him and everything, and his wife and his son are so scared, so they get in the car and they start, like, driving off, and in a hurry they end up getting in a car crash and dying. So then, Kingpin is, devastated, and, thinks if he gets a family from a parallel universe, that's the way of getting him back. Almost kind of in a sense, like in Multiverse of Madness, where Wanda wanted to get parallel universe versions of her sons to get them back in that way. So, but anyway, so Kingpin is successful, and his portal opens up all links to like all the other dimensions, or in essence the Spider-Verse, bringing in all these other, spider people, Spider-Gwen, another Peter Parker, Spider-Ham, I believe is his name, Spider-Man Noir, some anime Spider-Man chick that's not even really a Spider-Man, but we'll get to that later. But anyway, so as Peter Parker's trying to stop it, he gets like caught in the beam and like gets really fucked up and everything, and then Kingpin just like straight up kills him. He just like goes like bam and just freaking kills him. And so, so that so yeah, so Spider-Man, that Peter Parker Spider-Man is dead. And, it's really sad because, like I said, really like him, like Peter Parker, Spider-Man, and that's one of the big was one of the biggest turnoffs of the movie. But there was more. So then, when Miles Morales is at Peter Parker's grave, then another Peter Parker shows up, having come from a parallel universe, and this Peter Parker is just horrible. This is everything that a Spider-Man, a Peter Parker Spider-Man should not be. He is a fat, lazy, pathetic, selfish, narcissistic slob, which, like I said, is the complete opposite of Peter Parker Spider-Man's character. Spider-Man helps people, he cares about people, and he does, and he's, in shape and everything. But this Peter Parker, when I saw this in the previews, it's like, oh my God, this is just horrible. He's got 5 o'clock shadow, he's fat, out of shape, he's such a loser, and he's such a dick to Miles, and it's just, he just so hateable. He's not what Peter Parker should be. And yeah, it's like he just, because when Miles, wants him to train him to, like, be a Spider-Man, because he got bit by a radioactive spider too, and discovering his powers and shit. So, but that alternate universe Peter Parker is just like such a freaking dick to him. He's like, it's like, hey, no, don't worry about this kid, leave it to, to me. I'll do it. I'm the best, just shit like that. And it's just, he's just such a hateable dick. And it's so sad to see Peter Parker be like that, because that's not who Peter Parker is, or what Peter Parker is supposed to be. And I don't understand why fans weren't raging about that, because they rage about, everything, things like that in movies nowadays. So when they saw what they did to Peter Parker, why weren't people going to Twitter and trying to get the hashtag trending, like, not my Spider-Man, or, something like that? Why does this get a pass? Why is it okay to completely fuck up Peter Parker's character in this, and people give it a pass and call it the best movie? I don't understand. It's like, on the side of DC, if they fucked up Batman in that way, like, they made him not a billionaire, but a guy in high school, and his parents are still alive, and he doesn't call himself Batman, he calls himself Birdman. I don't know, but it's like, if they changed too much and made Batman everything that Batman's not supposed to be, people would raise hell. They would go to Twitter and they would be like, oh, this is gonna be terrible, a worse Batman movie, not gonna see this. This isn't who Batman, it's like, so I don't understand. It's like, if people lose their shit about, stuff like that, why didn't they lose their shit on what they did to Peter Parker in this? I can't wrap my head around. I don't understand it. So then they friggin' sneak into Kingpin's lab because they want to shut down his machine because he's gonna fire it up again and probably destroy the city. And they need basically like a little US, just like a little. Hang on a sec. I know I got one up here somewhere. Here we go. Just need basically one of these, just a little tiny USB drive that they plug into the top of the machine, and then that like stops it or like blows it up or something. So you just need one of these, but it's a lot more complicated than a regular USB drive because Peter Parker, Spider-Man in that universe made it, and then Miles breaks it, and so then they got to make another one. So they got to steal the technology to get to make another one, and he and pathetic Peter Parker go in there and. You know what, just to avoid like confusion and you know not having to say so many names, I'm just gonna call the Peter Parker from the alternate universe that's in this movie Pathetic Parker. So he and Pathetic Parker go in there and friggin' try to steal the technology and see the scientist that Fisk is working with. And here's another totally freaking thing that people should have lost their shit over. Freaking, they ruined the best Spider-Man villain of them all, Dr. Octopus, Dr. Otto Octavius, because it's not Dr. Otto Octavius, it's a chick named Dr. Olivia Octavius, and she's supposed to be Dr. Octopus in that universe. I'm like, you gotta be kidding me, you guys ruined my favorite Spider-Man villain of all time. Oh God, I hated Olivia Octavius. Oh God. So that was cringy as fuck finding that out. So then she chases them, yada yada, blah blah blah, and then stuff happens, plot, words, things, and then eventually Pathetic Parker and Miles go to Aunt May's house of the Aunt May of Miles Morales's Spider-Man Peter Parker that died. And she shows him like basically the spider cave, which I'll admit that was kind of neat. It was cool seeing all those Spider-Man outfits that he had. You had the classic one, you had the PS4 one, the big time Spider-Man, Iron Spider, you name it, they were all there. So that was kind of cool. But yeah, so Aunt May, you know, knew Peter Parker was Spider-Man and that he had his whole like secret lab lair thing, cave, whatever you want to call it, set up in underneath the shed. Underneath the shed. And so yeah, so then she brings him there and you know she wants to help them, and she's like, and it's like, you know, how, you know, why are you being so nice to us, or why are you doing this, or it's like, surely you can't think you're the first Spider-Man to come here or something. And so then we get to what should be the highlight of the movie, but for me was the worst part. I'm sorry. I was thankfully we go a whole hour without getting to see most of these people, so they're not in the movie for so long, which maybe disappointed people if they wanted them in there more. But for me, I was fine with it because I was not looking forward to these characters, right? Because that's the whole point of this. Like I said, it brings in more Spider-Men from parallel universes, and they just. Miles is okay. Spider-Gwen's not bad. I don't know anything about Spider-Noir, but Spider-Ham and anime Spider-Man chick just. Oh my god. Where do I even begin with that? So yeah, so that's what the whole point of the movie is. So, you know, so we finally. So then, you know, we get there and it's like, oh yeah, these guys are in there. I was going over an hour not seeing these guys and just having it be Miles and Pathetic Parker and then a little bit of Spider-Gwen or Ghost Spider, as she's now called. And yeah, so then when they come in, just it just tanks so hard, just goes way downhill. It just. Oh my God. So. I don't like Spider-Ham. I did not find him funny or didn't like anything about him. Thought he was completely stupid. You know me, I already don't like anime. So the fact that they put anime into this by having an anime Spider-Man chick known as Penny Parker, who doesn't even have spider powers. She can't like thwip or anything. She fights in some stupid ass red and blue robot suit that her dad made, and how does that make her a Spider-Man? Because it doesn't even have webs, it doesn't walk. It's just a big fighting fucking red and blue robot that she fights in, and there was no need for her, because she nothing about her screams being a Spider-Man or a spider person, whatever you want to call it. It's like, because yeah, she has no spider powers whatsoever, that she just uses this big ass stupid robot, and she just there was no need for her. She should have been omitted from the whole thing. She's for that. If they were gonna have her, they should have. Then that would have been better suited for an anime Spider-Man series from Japan, where Spider-Man isn't like, you know, like a web flipper or a wall crawler, but instead an anime chick that has a giant fighting robot. Then something like that, you know, might have worked a little better. But for this, it doesn't work, and it makes no sense because, again, she's not a Spider-Man because she doesn't have any spider powers or nothing about her. Nothing about her screams of Spider-Man. Nothing. Because, like I said, her robot doesn't wall crawl. Her robot doesn't have webs. It's just a red and blue fucking fighting robot that has Spider-Man's colors, and that's it. So, yeah. So, Spider-Ham and Penny Parker, just no. I hated them both. They really, they really made the last 45 minutes of the movie at this point, because I was like an hour and 3 minutes in, and it said I had like 45 minutes left. Give it more like 40 if you take away the credits, because the credits were like 5-6 minutes. So, but yeah, they just, I'm just there, you know, just like waiting for it to end, and I just don't want to see any more of these characters. And you're supposed to care about these characters, want to know more about these characters, but I did not give two shits about any of these characters. They did not make me want to pick up a Miles Morales comic, a Spider-Gwen comic. They didn't make me want to go research who Spider-Ham is and, you know, what his deal is, or who the fuck Penny Parker is and her giant fighting robot, and I didn't like Spider-Noir, but I don't hate Spider-Noir. Some things about Spider-Noir, I guess, are kind of cool. But again, Peter Parker is really the only Spider-Man for me that I really like. These other ones, like I said, I didn't give two shits about any of these characters. And when that happens, that's a problem for your movie, because you want people to care about these characters and know more about them. But I did not. They did not. No, and none of the jokes, I didn't laugh like once in this movie. None of the jokes landed for me. It's like, I don't know if I was supposed to be laughing at these or what, but just nothing landed. I didn't laugh at any of these jokes. I didn't find anything in this movie funny. The whole time, most of the time, I'm just sitting there bored out of my mind and regretting my life choices. Like, why am I even watching this? Why can't I be doing something else? Why did I decide to sit down and waste 2 hours of my life to watch this horrible movie? And I'm just there, just getting more and more bored and trying not to fall asleep. And it's just, yeah. So then all the friggin' they meet and interact, tell their stories, blah, 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 blah. And Miles tries to discover his powers, and they all tell him he's not ready, because if they put this little thing, which they call a goober, back inside of Kingpin's machine, then one of the spider people is going to have to stay behind while the other ones go in. So Miles says it should be him, but he doesn't have his powers intact yet, and he's not ready to fight, and, you know, all that stuff. And so but, yeah, through methods and, like, a pep talk and, you know, all that stuff, he eventually finally gets hold of his powers and, you know, is better and, you know, basically, you know, what should be, like, the cheering moment, like, oh, yeah, he got his costume, he got his powers, and, you know, you should be freaking out because he can do his stuff, and he goes to Aunt May's shed and he takes one of the Spider-Man suits and spray paints it black and gives it the red logo, which I should also point out, I don't like his costume in this. It's freaking, I get that it's supposed to be a bit more homemade and, you know, be more representative of graffiti, because, you know, he likes to do graffiti art, but it's like freaking, that's not what it, even though I'm not gonna watch it, I hope he gets a better freaking costume in Spider-Man Across the Spider-Verse, because yeah, his freaking costume is just lame. It's nothing. Oh, damn it, I forgot, in this version, I don't think they show the Miles Morales with the black suit yet, but it's black and I'll put a picture up on screen of what Miles Morales' suit is supposed to look like, and then on this side here, so here I will put two pictures up so you can see the comparison between the two suits, and you can see, so yeah, so his, Yeah, I did not like his suit at all. It's nothing like his suit in the comics, and I just yeah. So hopefully he gets a better suit in Across the Spider-Verse, but who knows? And at this point, I don't care. But who cares? Anyways, so yeah, so you know, like I said, you're supposed to be all excited. He gets his new suit, gets his powers and everything. But I'm just sitting there like, oh wow, he finally got his powers and he got his new suit. Whoopee! Yay! So then they go to Kingpin's party thing that he's having where he's claiming to be paying tribute to Spider-Man despite the fact that he's the one who killed him. And then they go in, crash the party, well, not crash the party really, I guess. They disguise themselves as butlers, not butlers, waiters and waitresses, because all the waiters and waitresses are dressed like Spider-Man to, quote, pay tribute to him, even though, you know, Kingpin, you know, is full of shit. And it's like, you know, it's like, I am so disheartened by the loss of Spider-Man. It's like, we're all here tonight gathered to celebrate a truly extraordinary man. Just every word coming out of his mouth is just total bullshit because he's the one who killed him. But obviously, they don't know that. But the only ones who know that are Miles and the other Spider people. But anyway, so they go underground and they have a fight with friggin' Kingpin and Olivia Octavius and Tombstone and what has to be to date the stupidest, stupidest, stupidest design of Scorpion to date. It's like he looks friggin' straight out of like a Borderlands kid. He's like if you took Face McShooty and made him like a big buff guy and gave him like a chainsaw arm and a claw. Oh, he looks horrible. It's nothing like Scorpion should be. It's like, why are you people okay with all these redesigns and backstory changes and you know, just and character ruining all this? Why are you people all okay with this and giving this a pass to consider it the best Spider-Man movie? I legitimately do not understand it. So yeah, so here is what, sorry, here is what Scorpion looks like in Into the Spider-Verse. Like I said, looks like a freaking straight out of Borderlands character. Nothing like Scorpion. This is what Scorpion's supposed to look like. Yeah, so total, yeah, oh my God, just horrible. So they fight them all, blah blah blah, yada yada. Miles shows up, saves the day. They stop them, and then all the spider people return back to their universes, and you know, and at that point, I was like, even though I know they return to their universes, friggin', they literally jump into the beam and like, so since these characters were leaving the screen one by one, I was kind of thinking to myself, it's like, okay, Spider Ham's dead, Anime Girl's dead, and okay, Spider Noir's dead, and Spider Gwen is dead, and this is a different Peter Parker. This isn't the good, this is pathetic Parker. So him going, it's okay. So then when he finally reluctantly jumped into the thing because he didn't want to because of all his marital problems with MJ, he didn't want to face her. He was married to her, but they got divorced and had a no, they never had a kid, sorry. They should have had a kid, but in this universe they didn't. So he jumped in and it's like, oh, and pathetic Parker's dead. It's like, but this isn't the real Peter Parker, so it's okay. I'm not bothered by it. Again, I know they're not dead, but it just, you know, I just said that, you know, to kind of make myself feel better, make it a little more bearable, and have them, like, you know, leave, you know, one by one. So it's like, oh, good, finally, out of the movie, you know. So it's like, so then it's just Miles versus Kingpin, and I neglected to mention this, but I guess I'll mention it originally. I guess it's kind of sort of spoilers, but everyone who wanted to see this movie by now has probably seen it. It's been 4 friggin' years it's been out, but friggin' Miles' uncle, who he looks up to, Aaron Davis, is working for Kingpin and known as the Prowler. And when he's tasked with killing Miles, he can't because he finds out the person he's chasing is Miles. So he has Miles by the throat and he's, you know, like in a claw him, but then Miles lifts up his mask and then he can't do it. And then Uncle Aaron gets shot by Kingpin and Miles takes him somewhere into an alley and says goodbye and he dies. And, you know, he should be raining tears and crying like, no, Uncle Aaron, no. And I'm just like, Okay, yeah, so Aaron, Uncle Aaron's dead. Oh wow, yeah, he died. Oh, so sad. I was being such a sarcastic asshole with the movie because I didn't care. I wasn't engaged. I wasn't entertained. I hated it. I wanted it to end. I wanted it to be over, and I just, yeah. So this nothing about this movie hooked me, engaged me, made me laugh, made me want to see it again, made me want to know more about it. Just n nothing. I was so disheartened, so disinterested with this movie, and now I'm glad that I can finally say that having seen it, because if I tell that to people, be like, oh, but you haven't even seen it, so how do you know? You know, it's like, but I should have gone with my first instinct. I knew I probably wasn't going to like this movie, and I wasn't going to consider it the best Spider-Man movie like everyone else did. And I was right. I was, I, yeah. So, yeah. Yes, I like I said, I did not like it at all, and I don't plan on ever watching it again. And I'm definitely not going to watch either of the sequels coming. And yeah, I just don't care. Do not care. And I know that may make me seem like an asshole, but I'm sorry. I didn't like it. I did not like it. So anyway, so back to the plot, if you could call it a plot, friggin' then Miles is fighting Kingpin, and Kingpin in this, holy shit, like it really made Kingpin like a friggin' other. I know Kingpin's supposed to be like big and fat, but this dude was like on the screen, he was like this fat. And like probably like this freaking tall, and compared to all that, his head was probably like this big, very, very unrealistic proportions. I know it's a cartoon, and they could make him as big or as fat as they want, you know, and you know, because you know, obviously, when you're doing live action, you can only make Kingpin so fat or big before it starts looking unrealistic, or before you're like, how is that guy even alive? He should be have diabetes, or you know, should be high blood pressure and heart condition, and all that's because you know, because someone that fat could not live a comfortable life, you know. And the way that they made Kingpin in this, yeah, you're gonna be asking all those questions like, how is this guy even alive at this point? You know, because he just, yeah, he just way too much of a. Like not even human, like almost like it's almost like they took Hulk and like gave him like no muscles, gave him like a really small hands and really small feet and a really small head, but just the same hulking body. It's just, yeah, I was not a fan of Kingpin's design in this at all. So Miles fights Kingpin, yada yada yada, and then he saves the day, and friggin' his dad, who's a cop who I've neglected to mention too, Jefferson Davis, who you probably all know about him, friggin' tries to call his son on his phone, and you know, his son's kind of been avoiding him because he doesn't want to tell him that he's Spider-Man because his dad hated the original Spider-Man, so doesn't think he'll accept him as Spider-Man. So, you know, classic thing. I was just like, oh, come on, just tell him you're Spider-Man already. Come on, he's your dad, he loves you, he'll accept you for it. So will your mom. It's like, don't be afraid, you know, just tell him. So, but yeah, but no, he keeps a secret, so probably his parents won't find out until the second or third movie, because like, yeah, that seems to be a reoccurring theme that you're that someone finds out the identity in the in usually either the first or the second movie, because in Sam Raimi Spider-Man, Mary Jane found out in at the end of Spider-Man 2, so that was the second one. Sorry, two. And then Iron Man was the first movie because he revealed his identity to everyone. He just flat out came out and said, "I am Iron Man." And then who else has revealed their identity in and how many movies it's taken? And then Spider-Man Homecoming, Aunt May found out right at the end of the first movie because Peter jumps down from the ceiling in the Spider-Man costume, and May's behind him and goes, "What the?" And then the movie ends. So that was really funny. But yeah, so chances are probably at least by the second movie that comes out next year across the Spider-Verse, Miles' parents will find out somehow that he's Spider-Man. Whoop-de-doo, yay! Anyway, so. So yeah, so he calls his dad as Miles, but then he jumps down as Spider-Man and tries to disguise his voice and maybe be like, it's like, yo, Mac, I'm the new Spider-Man here to help you know, and thank you for everything, you know. And so, yeah, and then friggin' Miles like swings through the city and, you know, says he's Spider-Man and that he's not the only one and, you know, yada yada, and then lays down on his bed, listening to some music, and then you hear Spider-Gwen be like, "Hey Miles, you got a minute?" And then the movie ends. So that, of course, sets up for Across the Spider-Verse, which, you know, comes out next year. So, you know, hinting at a sequel that, you know, they probably weren't sure if they were gonna make or not, but they did anyway. I thought the post-credit scene might, you know, like be like the setup for Across the Spider-Verse or something, and kind of sort of was, I guess. I mean, they brought in Spider-Man 2099. This may have been the only thing in the movie that got a little bit of a chuckle out of me, but still not that funny and didn't land as much as I think it should have or as they wanted it to. But Spider-Man 2099 gets the power to like jump across like multiple dimensions or travel back in time or something, and some unknown person is all like, you know, "Where do you want to go?" And he's like, "I want to go back to the beginning, to Earth 67." And so then he's in the freaking 67 animated Spider-Man cartoon and does the whole thing. He's like, "Who are you?" And it's like, "Who are you?" So they do the whole pointing thing that they're known for, but instead of the two Spider-Men that look exactly the same, now it's Spider-Man 2099. So that was a little clever. I'll give him props for that. To give credit where credit is due, you know, and that was a nice little joke that they, you know, had him travel back to the 67 Spider-Man series. Okay, that was kind of cool, I will admit. So, So yeah, so that was pretty much the Cliff Notes version of the movie, I guess you could say. Maybe more than Cliff Notes, because I go through the whole plot and not just like a synopsis. Most of the whole plot. I'm sure I left out some stuff that was probably important or, you know, spoiler territory that I just didn't talk about and bother. But what else? Another thing that I didn't like, aside from, you know, the movie itself, is the animation of this movie was atrocious. They were trying to go combine like a cartoony aspect as well as like a semi-realistic aspect, and trying to like put effects and everything, and at times it looked like you should be watching it with 3D glasses. Like, it's one of those movies that you know, it's like, yeah, it looks when you take off your 3D glasses and, you know, you got the red and blue lines, you know, overlapping and stuff, and it just at times it looked like that. It was really hard to look at. It was even hurting my eyes last night. I was like, "Oh God, what am I supposed to be wearing 3D glasses or what?" So I was not a fan of the animation style at all. I'm sure some people probably liked it, but I did not like it. I thought it was atrocious. It was hard to look at, and at times it looked like it should have been viewed in with 3D glasses, even though that probably wasn't the case. But, you know, that's just kind of what it looked like. What else? There was one other thing I was gonna mention. I'm trying to remember about the movie. What was that? I feel like there was one other thing I forgot to cover, because I covered the animation. I realized I forgot to cover the animation, so I said the animation. Runtime. Oh, music, for one thing, was not a fan of the music at all. Was not head bopping, but probably because it's not my style of music. It's mostly all hip hop and R&B, and I'm not into that kind of shit. So did not care for the music. Voice acting. Did not like the voice that they chose for Peter Parker. That's another thing that didn't scream Peter Parker and why they ruined his character, because that did not sound at all like Peter Parker should sound like. At times, I will admit, he kind of sounded maybe a bit like Toby, but for the most part, I just felt the voice was totally wrong for Peter Parker. That they should have cast someone else, because I did not like Peter Parker's voice actor at all. No, so yeah. Shameik Moore was fine. I know Shameik Moore from Incredible Crew. I love that Cartoon Network series. Shame it only lasted one season. If you don't know what I'm talking about, the thing will be up here in the corner, a little thumbnail of the show. So yeah, so the kid from that show is the one voicing Miles Morales here, and he did a fine job. You know, it's nothing. You know, I got nothing against him. I have no idea who was doing Spider-Ham, but I feel he was trying way too hard to be funny and be the comic relief, because he was not. I wasn't laughing at any of his jokes. I just found him annoying and cringy as fuck. And so, Another plot element I forgot to mention is Penny Parker. We're supposed to feel like sympathy and all sad and everything, when her robot's destroyed and she has to leave it behind, and I was feeling nothing. I was just sitting there like, oh no, the robot's destroyed. Oh, that's gonna have to leave it behind. And of course, she rebuilds it and she'll be back in the sequel. So, that's another thing. That's why I didn't really feel for her because I know it's not really dead or not really broken. I don't know. It's complicated whether that thing count like was alive or if it was just a regular robot or I don't know. But this movie was just a gigantic mess. It just was not entertaining at all. I didn't like the characters, didn't like the story, didn't like the designs, didn't like the anime. I can't think of a single thing about this movie that I liked. I like I said, that little tiny chuckle at the whole Spider-Man 2099 pointing meme, but other than that, I can't think of a single thing I actually liked about this movie. So I think I've covered just about everything. Just really quickly, just not gonna spend too much time talking about it. We can do that in another video if we need to, but I think Spider-Man No Way Home is actually the superior Spider-Verse movie, and I think it is loads better than Into the Spider-Verse, and I would consider that the best Spider-Man movie of all time. Maybe they considered Into the Spider-Verse the best movie before No Way Home, and now that No Way Home has come out, then people are like, oh no, No Way Home is actually the best Spider-Man movie. I would hope that's the case. I really hope, but I'm really not 100% sure. But I myself consider this the best Spider-Man movie of all time. Spider-Man No Way Home with five villains and three Spideys. So, and just really quick, I'm just gonna go over 10 reasons, 10 quick reasons why I think Spider-Man No Way Home is better than Into the Spider-Verse. And these are in like no particular order, like the number 10 reason and the number one reason. These are just 10 random reasons of why Spider-Man No Way Home is better. Spider-Man isn't dead. Spider-Man isn't a dick. Spider-Man isn't a loser. More interesting characters. Three Peter Parkers. 20 years of Spider-Man movies together in one film. Tobey Maguire and Andrew Garfield. That's a big win right there. Better jokes. The jokes were landing so much better in that movie, and I was laughing, probably like every 5 minutes of that stuff. No spider ham, spider pig thing, and no anime girl Spider-Man. Those 10 reasons right there are what I think make Spider-Man No Way Home bet a better movie and the best Spider-Man movie compared to Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse. Okay, well, there was my almost, geez, like 35-minute rant there almost, wasn't it? I knew it was going to take a while, but I didn't think it was going to take that long. That's actually even longer than than both my Sonic and Mario debate, as well as why I like Sonic 06 and think it's a good Sonic game. That one was only like 20 minutes, and I don't remember how much the other rant video was, but this was definitely the longest, and I was not expecting it to be, but thank you, those of you who watched to the end and listened to what I have to say, and hopefully maybe you guys can let me know in the comments and help me understand why Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse is your favorite Spider-Man movie, why people consider it the best, why it won over critics. Like, what it is in this movie that I'm missing? What is it about this movie that appeals to so many people? Because, like I said, it did not appeal to me, so kind of help me understand. Let me know your thoughts and opinions of this movie in the comments below, but try and be respectful, please. That's all I ask. Also, be sure to share this video with your friends, subscribe, and hit that notification bell so you don't miss the next video. And until next time, guys, this is the Ultimate Frozen Fan flashing my Spider-Man No Way Home shirt with Tom Holland, Andrew Garfield, and Tobey Maguire. Signing off. Peace.